Radio. It is time to head into the chat room now with Nine's Neil Breen in Sydney and Nine's Alan Ruskell in Melbourne. Good afternoon to both of you.
Hey, guys.
Good afternoon, Belinda. Hey, Alan.
Hey, Neil.
First up to a shocking 2-year investigation by the ABC uncovering the cruel treatment of racehorses in this country, with allegations hundreds are being sent to the slaughterhouse. Here's a clip from last night's 7:30 report.
The problem is massive, and the reason why it is so big is because they're breeding too many horses. They're breeding more than they need, hoping that they can breed the one that's going to be the next Maccabi Diva or Winx or Black Caviar.
Racing authorities have today strongly condemned the horrific images. Bruni, it's appalling. I mean, does it surprise you, or is this something that people in the industry have known about for some time but not spoken about?
I don't know, Belinda, that people in the industry have known about it. And it is shocking and it is distressing, but we're predominantly dealing here with one abattoir at Caboolture, which is just north of Brisbane. I think some of the statements that have come out saying that it's enormous and it's widespread are too big. I don't think the problem is that large. In saying that, there's a problem. Because what was shown on the 7:30 report last night is simply not good enough for the racing industry. And the racing industry knows it. And as a person who's had shares in racehorses myself, it makes me sick to my stomach, Belinda, that anyone could treat any animal that way, let alone a racehorse. And I think one of the key things in the industry, and that I've always done, is that when a racehorse finishes its career, there's a home for it. Mm. You can find people who want to take a racehorse. Kids use them as dressage horses, all sorts of purposes that can be found for them. And some of them end up in the slaughterhouse and are killed like that is simply just not good enough, Belinda. But I think we need to just be careful. We're not talking about thousands upon thousands here. We're talking about some racehorses that end up there. And the fact that some do is not good enough.
Yeah. Al, I mean, as we heard before, some are saying that the biggest problem is too many horses being bred because they're looking for that next Winx.
Yeah, look, I take on board what Neil has said, but I can't believe that a sport that relies on these majestic animals to function would treat them in this way. It's absolutely horrendous. I'm surprised there's not already a national registry in place here in Victoria. The government cracked down on dog breeders and puppy farms, so I see no reason why such schemes, you know, shouldn't be extended to encompass the horse breeding industry. And I know every industry does have its bad apples, but the racing industry does seem to attract, you know, quite a lot of attention, so maybe it's time it started cleaning up its act a little, much like the taxi industry. If it doesn't take care of what makes it money, then it'll, you know, it'll lead to all sorts of trouble, and don't kill the golden goose, guys.
Well, at least it's been highlighted now, so as you say, Bruni, if it is just a few that are doing the wrong thing, that soon there'll be prosecutions or something to stop it. Anyway, let's move on. More than 500,000 drivers in New South Wales have been hit with a traffic fine over the past year. The government raking in $104 million in revenue, one red light camera on Sydney's Eastern Distributor raising a whopping $4.3 million alone. The NRMA today calling for an investigation into the biggest money-making cameras. Alan, is the government just being greedy, or is it fair? You speed, you get caught, you get a fine.
Yeah, I agree with you. I've got to be honest, I'm not surprised that these speed cameras are raking in so much money. Why? Because, you know, we have so many knuckle-dragging mouth breathers who somehow get a licence and think it's a licence to do whatever they want to on the road. I mean, how many times have you been going the speed limit and then some complete moron roars past you? Having done TV news for 30 years, sadly I've seen the end result of such stupid actions, the crumpled cars, the bodies lying on the road. At the end of the day, if you don't want to get fined for speeding, just don't speed.
Yeah, road death tolls, they seem to just keep rising. Bruni, what do you think? Should the government be doing more to make roads safer, like look at the warning signs and check that they're working?
Yes, they should, Belinda. And look, I totally agree with what Alan said. If you're speeding, if you're doing 110 in an 80 zone, you're an imbecile. You should lose your licence. But I think a lot of these fines are technicalities. People are caught out when there's roadworks and it goes from 80 to 40 in the Eastern Distributor at 11 p.m. and people are doing 51, 57. They don't realise they're behind a truck. They don't see the signs. They can't see the workers on the roads. The other morning I was driving out to Rosehill to do a racehorse story very, very early in the morning. So I went across the Anzac Bridge at 4:30 a.m. and there was a speed gun there, and eight people have been pulled over because there's not a car on the road and they're all doing over 60. And I think there's a lot of revenue raising involved in it. And I would like to see a lot more targeted campaigns at people who are doing the seriously wrong thing, not getting busted on technicalities.
Yeah, and it's pretty hard to get out of those fines, isn't it, Breenie?
It's impossible.
Yeah. Let's head straight back into the chat room with Neil Breen and Alan Rascal. Now, cops are known for handing out fines, as we were talking about before, but what about car seats? Auckland police have set up a checkpoint to see how well children under seven are strapped in. But instead of giving tickets to those who failed the test, they're offering free car seats. Breenie, do you like this idea?
Oh, I love it, Belinda. See, this is what I think is proactive policing. Mm-hmm. Now, firstly, if your car seat's no good and you've got a kid in it, then I'm not real happy with that. But I like the fact that police are saying, hey, we can help you here, we can give you this, we can give you that. Rather than just slapping out fines, you're doing the wrong thing, you're doing the wrong thing. Hey, you've got a problem here. Hey, we as police officers, it's our job to try and help citizens of a country or a state. Here's something that can help you. I absolutely love this, Belinda.
Yeah, because, I mean, there are plenty of families, cash-strapped families, and car seats, they're not cheap, are they,
Breenie? Expensive. They're very expensive. They're hard to install if you don't know how to do it or it's your first kid and you've never done it before. I've been doing it for a friend of mine. I won't tell you his name, but it might rhyme with Ben Fordham. I've been putting his car seats in for years, Belinda.
Oh, that's crazy. You've got to teach him how to do it. I think he's got you there. Now, Alan, what do you think? Should Aussie police follow this lead of the New Zealand counterparts?
Well, look, I guess I agree with both of you guys. I mean, car seats are pretty expensive, but at the end of the day, what price a life, I ask? I mean, why would you risk your child's life by not having the appropriate child seat or restraint or not fitting them properly? We all have rules we've got to live by. It's all part of our lives, and I think people should be fined for doing the wrong thing, but I do applaud this particular move as the police are clearly putting the child's safety first, which is more than can be said for some parents.
Yeah, but that's it though, Breenie. It can be confusing for parents too, can't it? The rules.
Exactly right. Because as your kids get older, so they've got to be in a forward-facing seat. And when they're a baby, they have to be in the seat that faces backwards.
Is it the age of seven or is it the size that they are, like how tall they are?
Yeah, and at certain ages, they've got to have the straps built into the seat over their shoulders.
Yeah.
Then they're allowed to go into a booster seat where they use a seat belt that goes across them. Although, I'm a bit of a stickler for these rules, Belinda, so if you ever have any issues or your friends have issues, you come and see me, bring the car into the Channel 9 car park and I'll sort it for you.
We'll see you tomorrow. Okay, let's move on. And how well did you sleep last night, boys? If you have kids, well, there's a good chance you didn't get as many Z's as you wanted. Mm. Research has revealed 85% of Victorian households are affected by lost sleep. Parents missing out on up to 5 hours a night because children are suffering from bedtime anxiety or sleeping issues. Breenie, is this just part of being a parent, or should we be more concerned about the effect it has on everyone's well-being?
It's just part of being a parent. My oldest daughter, Juliet, turns 15 today, Belinda. I can't believe it.
Happy birthday, Juliet.
Happy birthday, Juliet. And I feel as though that I haven't been sleeping properly for those whole 15 years. The party ended 15 years ago, but a new party started and you just got to deal with it. Look, for sleeping for myself, I got no problems falling asleep, right? I can fall asleep at any time of night. My problem is I wake up too early and I can't go back to sleep.
Ah. Do you need to go back to sleep or it's way too early?
No, well, sometimes it's way too early.
Yeah. Anyway. It's hard because all kids are different, but often, you know, you try and set up the same routine at night, but sometimes, you know, things just don't work. Alan, plenty of adults without kids also struggle. Do you think it's screen time? Is that what's to blame?
Yeah, that and discipline. I mean, if technology is proving so problematic for sleep, the solution's pretty simple. Stop using or misusing that technology. Turn off your devices in the bedroom, or better still, don't even take them in. Experts say, you know, you do need a bit of extra downtime before bedtime, so get off your devices before turning in for the night. And when it comes to kids' sleeping habits, the parents should probably parent. Take the devices off the kids and send them to bed at an appropriate time. Problem solved.
Yeah, but it's hard because the iPad, sometimes that's how they read, right, Breenie? They read their stories off the iPad.
Yeah.
Mm. Anyway.
What the problem is? They get given... So my son's 5, my daughters are 12 and 15. The 12 and 15-year-olds, they get given laptops at school.
Yes.
But what can a laptop computer do?
No.
What can it do, Alan and Belinda? It can get onto Wi-Fi.
Yeah, right. Yes. And then
please.
They can be up all night. Okay, we've got to get on to our last topic. It is Friday and most of us will be knocking off for the weekend, but one tradie in Sydney has walked off the job for good after winning the $50 million lotto jackpot.
Adeline, lucky bugger.
Would you quit?
Oh, my God, look, as much as I love you guys, you wouldn't see me for dust. As you know, I'm already a real house husband of Melbourne. I don't work full-time, so if I won a lotto, it'd give me even more time to sip lattes with the South Yarra tennis mums.
And you'd buy another Rolls, no doubt, or two,
absolutely.
Or three.
Yeah.
Brini, what would you do?
I'll show you what I'd do, Belinda. Mic off.
Oh, Brini.
He's out of here.
Bye-bye.
Oh, no. No more Brini, Al.
I know. Oh, good Lord. See you, Brini.
Oh, you too.
He's,
I don't know.
He's off to fit a few concerts,
I'd be booking a holiday, but I don't know. I'd probably still keep working, maybe just 2 days a week. See you, Brini. Bye, Alan.
Bye.
Thanks very much.
I can't hear a word you're saying. Bye-bye.
Good pun.